So, good morning, everybody. So I would like to thank the organizers to give me the opportunity to give this talk. So I will present the lessons learned from here for exoplanet imaging with the ELT instrument METIS. So I led the commissioning activities and performance analysis of a near coronagraph with a large group of people from the Vortex and near teams. So just to remind you the context of the project, which was already presented by Marcus yesterday. So near was a 100-hour mid-infrared search for rocky planets in the habitable zone of Alpha Centauri. So it was a collaboration between ESO and Breakthrough Initiatives. So the VLT instrument this year was upgraded and coupled with the Adaptive Optics Facility. So near, so the University of Liège provided a vortex coronagraph for near. So near is also a Pinefinder experiment for ELT METIS, as several components of the observing strategy for METIS were specifically implemented for near, and it was the first time for mid-infrared observations. So after a successful commissioning in April-May 2019, we completed the campaign in May-June of the same year. So we recorded about 75 hours of good data, and I refer to Marcus' talk and the poster by Kevin Wagner on the data analysis. So Marcus already showed this plot yesterday, but just to remind you why we chose to observe Alpha Centauri in the first place. So this is the planet-to-star contrast as a function of the maximum separation. So our main limitation is the resolution limit of an 8-meter telescope at 10 micrometers, which is about 250 mass. So this prevents to observe many nearby stars like Proxima Centauri, despite the more favorable contrast, because the habitable zone cannot be reached. So if we focus on the very few systems with habitable zones angularly resolvable, we see that basically Alpha Cen is the most favorable target in terms of contrast, but still the contrasts are larger than a million. So the dashed line here shows the visier sensitivity without adaptive optics reached in 1 hour. And so from this level, if we had to go to the sensitivity to image planets around Alpha Cen, we would need a very long integration time, so well beyond 100 hours. So the motivation to couple visier with adaptive optics was to reduce the requirement on the integration time. So Marcus has already discussed the visier upgrades for near, but I will only focus on the components which have a strong impact for exoplanet imaging. So the waveform sensing is performed inside visier, but in the red band of the spectrum, so at much shorter wavelengths than the near observations. And because there is no atmospheric dispersion corrector inside visier, we were expecting strong effects of differential atmospheric refraction. And we also measured and corrected for the non-common path aberrations between the waveform sensing channel and the science channel. The waveform correction is performed with a deformable secondary mirror of the VLT telescope, so with the adaptive optics facility. So this allows to limit the number of additional optical surfaces and to reduce the overall instrument emissivity. So this is important also for coronagraphy to take the best of the coronagraphic performance. We use the broadband feature covering the 10-12.5 micrometer range. So such a large range has a strong impact on the design of a coronagraph because the coronagraphic performance is chromatic. And finally, we designed the vortex coronagraph with an apodized heliostop, and I will discuss these more right now. So we used an annular groove phase mask, or AGPM. So it uses an axis symmetric subwavelength grating to introduce a phase shift to cancel out the starlight. So these microscope pictures show the manufactured device. So AGPM offers several nice features compared to other coronagraphs. So it provides a full discovery space down to the resolution limit. It has a high throughput and can work on large spectral bandwidths. However, AGPM, like other coronagraphs with small inner working angles, are sensitive to a suboptimal centering of a star behind the mask because, for instance, of tip-tip aberrations, or to a central obscuration of the telescope. So the near AGPM focal plane masks were designed and manufactured by our team, so at University of Liège, University of Uppsala in Sweden, and Caltech. So this diagram here shows in green the theoretical rejection performance on the near spectral bandwidth. So it's larger than 1,000 up to 5,000 at the center of the bandwidth. So in practice, the rejection performance is lower because wavefronts in real instruments are not perfectly flat. So the near EGPM for coplane masks were tested on the TIMI2 infrared bench at isogarking before being integrated inside VIZIR. So associated with this EGPM for coplane mask, we designed an apodized heliostope to attenuate as much as possible the diffracted starlight from the Alpha Centauri stars, as shown in this simulated image without any coronagraph. If we used a conventional heliostope, so conventional heliostope is a binary mask to cover typically the central obscuration of the telescope. So this is the dark feature, night black feature here, and the telescope spiders. It would not be very good for our observations because we would still be annoyed by the diffraction pattern of the secondary star of the Alpha Centauri system, which is not behind the coronagraphic mask. So to mitigate this diffraction pattern, to be able to search for planets around the star, which is behind the EGPM mask, we modified the heliostope to add apodization features. So these are these small additional features that you see here compared to the conventional heliostope. So the central obscuration of the heliostope is about 35%. The throughput within an aperture of 1 λ/d is 50% of the core throughput of the VLT pupil. And the raw contrast provided are below 5 × 10⁻⁶ at 1129 λ/d. With a more aggressive apodization, we could reach higher contrast, but in the mid-infrared, the main limitation is the instrument emissivity. So that in the end, we would achieve a lower final contrast. So we had to find the trade-off between the two. And so the images on the right show the image obtained with an apodized heliostope with a strong attenuation of the diffraction pattern of the secondary star from 3 to 8 arcseconds. So EGPM is sensitive to a suboptimal centering of a star behind the EGPM mask. Also, the star may drift out of the coronagraphic mask during the observation. So to achieve and maintain a good centering of a star behind the focal plane mask, we adapted the Cassis method, which stands for Coherent Analysis of Coronagraphic Images for Tipped Sensing. So Cassis uses the coronagraphic images themselves to estimate the stellar offset, so it does not require additional calibration data, contrary to other techniques. So Cassis was implemented for short infrared observations, so at Keck, but the implementation for near was not warranted because mid-infrared observations are very, very specific, especially there is a high and varying mid-infrared background that could induce SNR and bias issues. So we had to verify with simulations that Cassis can work in such a case. So this is what I have done. So I show here a series of simulated images in the near configuration. So the star is offsetted toward the left. So near a perfect centering, we see that the flux distribution between the image lobes is nearly equal. So it's not exactly the case because there is a flux asymmetry induced by the M3 support structure in the VLT pupil. So the VLT pupil is not perfectly symmetric. So when increasing the offset, we see that the diffraction, the coronagraphic pattern does not get brighter in the direction of the offset, so on the left, but on the opposite direction. But for larger offsets, it becomes brighter in the direction of the offset. And this nonlinear behavior is due to the central obscuration of the telescope. So for this reason, Cassis, in its practical implementation, does not use the inner part of the coronagraphic pattern, but the outer ring, which has a linear behavior with the offset for small offsets. So one issue with using the outer part of the coronagraphic pattern is that it is quite faint, especially for small telescope obscuration, which is the case of the VLT, which is only 14%. So this induces additional SNR issues on top of the mid-infrared background. So my work was to verify that Cassis can work in such situations. So first, I performed simulations to verify that Cassis can provide centering accuracies within the near requirements, which are 1/30 λ/d or 10 mass. So for this, I performed simulations with various known offsets to check the fidelity of the offset estimation and validate the Cassis model parameters, which were optimized on another simulated data set. So this image shows a coronagraphic image within white, the region which is used by Cassis to estimate the stellar offset. And the diagrams on the right compare the measured and simulated offsets in the horizontal and vertical directions. So we see that the offsets agree up to about 0.5 lambda over d. There is a bit of discrepancy, but this is not a strong issue because we expect CASIS to work in a regime of small offsets, so typically below 0.2 lambda over d. So this validates the calibration of the CASIS model. However, if we look at the smallest offsets, so typically below 0.1 lambda over d, we note a discrepancy between the measured and simulated offsets, which is due to the flux asymmetry induced by the M3 superstructure in the VLT telescope pupil. So to account for this, for the on-sky operation of CASIS, we introduced a set point parameter in the CASIS model. So after validating the CASIS model parameters, I determined the integration time needed to achieve good SNR and robust CASIS measurements. So this is important because if the integration time is long, the star may have drift out of the chronographic mask in the meantime. This has also another important consequence is that for if the stability of a PSA behind the AGPM mask without any active control is not very good, this will limit the CASIS performance. So I performed simulations with CASIS. So I analyzed the data with a simulated background photon noise. So for this, I used Vizier AGPM data, which were obtained on Sky before the near upgrade. So this is the chronographic image with the background photon noise. So the SNR achieved in 90 milliseconds is about 7, which is good for robust CASIS measurements. So we see that the measurements are quite similar to what we achieve without any background photon noise, so which means that the SNR is enough and that CASIS is able to measure a high frequency stellar offsets even for mid-infrared observations where the noise is very high. So finally, I evaluated the impact of residual wavefront aberrations on the CASIS performance. So CASIS is not intended to correct for fast stellar jitter induced by the atmospheric turbulence. So in fact, the quality of the CASIS correction may be limited by the poor correction from the adaptive optics. So to evaluate this, so I used the simulated adaptive optics phase screens with parameters similar to the VLT AOF. So this is the resulting image on the left, an example image from the sequence. And on the right, I show the offset estimates from CASIS in the XY plane. So we recover this bias of 0.01 lambda over d in each direction, which is induced by the M3 superstructure in the VLT pupil. But except for that, the adaptive optics correction is not a limitation for the CASIS performance. So I will now move to the on-sky test with CASIS. So Marcus has already showed this image yesterday. So this is a typical chopped image obtained from near. So this is the chronographic pattern here and the out-of-mask PSF of AlphaSNA and AlphaSNB. So for AlphaSNA, the pattern is negative because of the chopping. So this horizontal stripe on the AlphaSNA PSF is due to a local detector defect. And the atypical appearance of the out-of-mask PSF is due to the apodized LEO stop, so which was designed to mitigate the diffraction light close to the coronagraph to look for planets. So during the night, so the field of view rotates around the center because of the pupil tracking. So the fact we are chopping between the two alpha and A stars in Gabrielian chopping, the chronographic pattern is not only the chronographic pattern around the A star or the B star, but the subtraction of the two. So this is a bit atypical. And if we also look closer at the chronographic pattern, we see that it is quite different from the simulated pattern. And in fact, the observed pattern is expected from theory because we are in a regime of almost perfect centering and corrected wavefront. So this is the theoretical paper by Dimitri Mawe in 2005. Also in our simulations, we assume perfect AGPM mask, so without any intrinsic stellar leakage, while we expect some leakage from real devices. And for these reasons, we re-optimize the CASIS model parameters using on-sky commissioning data. So this is the workflow for CASIS for near observations. So we adapt the workflow designed for CAC observations, so for short near-infrared observations in several points. So the first step is to measure the position of the AGPM mask as seen from the detector. So this measurement is critical because it defines the reference of the CASIT's measurements. So hopefully the position of the AGPM in mid-infrared observations can be easily identified thanks to the vortex center glow effect. So this is due to the fact that there is no pupil stop upstream of the AGPM. So the thermal emission located outside of the telescope pupil is partly diffracted back into the telescope pupil because of the AGPM. So the structure of the glow can be approximated by two 2D Gaussian patterns associated respectively to the thermal emission located outside and inside the telescope pupil. So the second step in the workflow is to obtain background images in chopping mode to determine the chopping residual. So this is done every 1 hour. So we talk more about this later. Then the science images are obtained in chopping mode and they are subtracted from the chopping residuals. Then they are sent to CASITS. So CASITS measure the aperture photometry on the alpha sen A and B stars. Then the differential intensity is computed and normalized using the photometry measured on the stars. And CASITS returns the pointing offset. And finally, the pointing offset is converted into a correction offset for the field selector of the telescope. So steps 3 to 6 are repeated for about 1 hour, then step 2 and the subsequent loop are repeated. So I mentioned that the importance of the stability of the AGPM position overnight for CASITS. So these instabilities could occur because of differential fixtures or thermal drift inside the instrument. So we performed tests with Vizier with a telescope dome closed using various trajectories of a telescope. So with different altitudes with respect to the horizon. And we demonstrate that the position of the AGPM is quite stable. So the curve typical for alpha sen is the gray curve. In this case, the stability of the AGPM position is better than 0.5 pixels, so 22 mass. During the first on-sky test with CASITS, we noticed a residual bias in the measurements of about 0.2 lambda over d. So this is due to that the background after chopping is not perfectly uniform as seen on this animation. So we had to modify the observing strategy to obtain background calibration data in chopping mode. However, if you look closer to this animation, you will see at some point that the pattern evolves with time. And so this is due to the use of a pupil tracking for high contrast imaging. And because of that, we had to take regular calibration data to remove chopping residuals. So on the bottom, I show the final results of the on-sky test with CASITS. So we applied a series of offsets in two orthogonal directions. So these are the small squares in this XY diagram. So the plus and crosses are the measurements. And on the left, I show an animation with the test only one direction. So this is the image and the offset, which is measured by CASITS. And the diagram on the right compare the measured and applied offsets. And we see that they agree up to 0.5 lambda over d as expected. So we also measured the rejection of the AGPM coronagraphs on sky. So this is the contrast as a function of the angular separation. So the AGPM curve is the black solid curve, so measured on sky. So the curve is normalized to the peak of a non-coronagraphic PSF and the profile is shown here as the dashed curve. And as a dotted curve, we show the expected rejection performance of the perfect AGPM from our simulations. So without any stellar leakage, so the discrepancy at the shortest separations between the solid and the dotted curves due to the stellar leakage. So on axis, we measured on sky a rejection factor of about 100, but in the lab, we were able to measure about 400 for the rejection. And so we proposed the two scenarios to explain this discrepancy. So first, the AGPM performance is strongly wavelength dependent and that it degrades beyond the operating wavelength of the TIMI2 bench at Isogarking, so it could not be measured in the lab, or that the on-sky performance was degraded because of a nitrogen leak from the Vizier cryostat. So finally, I show in this diagram the estimated pointing error from CASITS over time, so in both X and Y directions. So this illustrates the closed-loop performance of CASITS over a full night of a near campaign. So CACIDS is able to achieve pointing accuracies of 0.015 lambda over d RMS over 4 hours around meridian passage, so which is here. And if we look at the cumulative offset, so this is the diagram on the right, we see that the curves display parabolic shapes, which are characteristic of a correction for differential atmospheric refraction. And this was expected because the wavefront sensing is performed at a different wavelength and there is no ADC inside this year. So the lessons learned from NIR for exoplanet imaging are very relevant for METIS for several reasons. So like NIR, METIS will use adaptive optics, vortex coronagraphy, and chopping only for the background subtraction. In order to use AGPM coronagraphy in the best conditions, pointing control in real time is needed. So for that, we implemented the CACIDS PFOD for mid-infrared observation. So this was the first on-sky validation at these wavelengths for this kind of observations. So CACIDS strongly benefits from a stable star image behind the AGPM mask, which is provided by a good adaptive optics correction. CACIDS also strongly benefits from the stable position of the AGPM as seen from the detector. So this is provided by a rigid mechanical structure of the instrument. And for this year, it is subpixel. We show that the high and variable mid-infrared background and the small VLT obscuration do not cause any SNR issues for getting good CACIDS measurements. As for the bias issues induced by the mid-infrared background, we adapt the observing strategy to take regular measurements of the chopping residuals. And finally, CACIDS also benefits from a stable photometric calibration. And thanks to chopping at mid-infrared, for mid-infrared observations, the calibration is almost simultaneous. And we do not need to record additional data as it is the case for shorter near-infrared observations. So with CACIDS, we were able to achieve pointing accuracies of 0.015 lambda over d RMS over several hours in good conditions. So this makes CACIDS a robust approach for the pointing control of the vortex coronagraphs of METIS. And I will finish with this last point, is that it is important to have mid-infrared lab benches covering wide bandwidth for AGPM testing, and a dedicated facility is under development at CES Saclay. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Annelise, and thank you for staying on time. So we have time for a few questions if you want. I don't see too many in the Slack channel yet, but you still can raise your hand. Otherwise, I will read the question. No hands in the participants. Okay, I'll read the questions from Slack. So there are two by Leo. Let's see the first one. So in your talk, it looked like the apodized light stop has a larger central obscuration than the default one. Does increasing the central obscuration really lead to a cleaner PSF? Is the first question.
So I think Leo is referring to this one. Yeah, the idea of using a larger central obscuration for video stop is to block the diffraction light from the telescope tower and the M3 support structure, so it improves the contrast.
And regarding CACIDS, you said that even with perfect centering, there is no perfect symmetry in the outer ring due to the asymmetry in the pupil, the M3 mirror, but that should be masked out or not?
That's on the next slide.
Yes, so it's particularly the case for the inner part. So this flux asymmetry here, so this is due to the, so it's, we see this feature really for centering close to perfect centering. So basically, it's mostly seen for the inner part of the coronagraphic pattern, but for the outer ring, it's not really significant.
Okay, and then I think the last question, also from Leo, is you say that the background was high and variable, and yesterday we heard from Marcus Kasper that the background was stable and therefore the pupil stabilized ADI style observations were sufficient and nodding is not required. So what's up with the background?
Yeah, I think this is due to because for CACIDS, we integrated the data cubes over 30 seconds, something like this. So 24 seconds of useful integration time. So the background, the structures were, the SNR on these structures were higher than what was for the science data, because the science data, the binning was less. So it was a few seconds.
Okay, thank you.
I can also have a quick comment, sorry.
Yeah, go ahead.
So my comment was more for the high frequency stripy patterns that you see in the field stabilized observation. So those go away when you do the pupil stabilized observations with the cold stop. These low spatial frequencies patterns that quite well subtract with the spatial filtering the image. These are there, and they are coming from the coronagraph. So if you don't have the coronagraph in the field of view, they are not there. But they subtract quite well out with the spatial filtering.